بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وبه نستعين.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. أسألك علما نافعا وعفوا واسعا وعافية من كل بلاء، ونعوذ بك من الشر كله. ثم أما بعد، يا أيها الذين أمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. يا أيها الذين أمنوا اتقوا الله وكونوا مع الصادقين. My dear brothers, جزاكم الله خيرا for your invitation. And the topic today is about the Shia, the rejectors. They call themselves Shia. أهل السنة والجماعة, they call them the rejectors, because they have rejected the Abu Bakr رضي الله عنه, and the Umar and the Uthman رضي الله عنهم, and also because they have rejected one of their imams when he refused to curse Abu Bakr, Umar and Uthman, as the late extreme Shia have made it one of the essentials of the Mazhabs and the descendants of Ahlul Bayt. They refuse to follow them in that. So Ahlul Sunnah al-Jama'ah, they call them the rejectors. They like to call themselves Shia. And they call us al-Nawasib, which is the people who have appointed, unhappily appointed, Abu Bakr, Umar and Uthman before Ali radiallahu anhum, all of them. And also because we are their enemies. So they call us al-Nawasib. Al-Nawasib in Arabic, it means the enemies who are always standing in the front of their enemies, and they don't outfocus their enemies. Many people probably think that the Shia is just another mazhab of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. Others, they think that it is fitna to talk about Shia, and let us all come and unite against our enemies. And some of the so-called Salafis, the Saudi followers, sometimes they are confused, because sometimes their government is cursing the Shia and forced them to curse the Shia. The next, they are happy with the Shia, they invite them and they make peace treaty with them and they make this and that. So again, those are the people who are suffering because of their worship to the sheikhs and governments. So they are here and there all the time. They cannot make up their mind whether the Shia is their friends or their enemies as their sheikhs. And recently we just found that although the Saudi government was cursing the Shia in the time where she was fighting Saddam and provoking people against the Saudi families, and when one of their sheikhs in Medina just a month ago, he made a khutbah against the Shia, he was stopped from delivering the khutbah, Sheikh Huzaifi, and the khutbah, we've got actually the tape for that khutbah. And this is not the way of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah to make friends with the enemies of Allah one time and then reject them the other time. We should have one certain policy. The danger from the Shia, it came to the extent historically that they have controlled Morocco, Tunisia, Algeria, Libya, and they've even gone into Egypt, and they've controlled Egypt for 300 years, 280 years. Egypt was Shia, fully Shia. And the Shia ruler there, Al-Fatimi, he used to curse the Khalifa Al-Abbasi in Iraq. And they've controlled Yemen, and they have controlled Pakistan, and they have controlled many of the areas, and still in Egypt and Pakistan suffering from the bid'ahs of the Shia up to our dates. Until Salah al-Din al-Ayyubi, rahimahullah, freed Egypt from Shia after 300 years and Yemen. And this is even the history, thank Salah al-Din al-Ayyubi, until now, it was even more important to liberate Palestine from Jews and Christians, to liberate Egypt and Yemen and the Sunni Muslims from the evil of Shia. When they are in power, they do kill and humiliate Sunni Muslims, and they force their bid'ahs upon people, as many times in the history they have done. And it's enough to see the book of Khomeini to praise that person, which is called Nasruddin al-Tusi. He said, and the Shia in history can never forgive, can never forget the benefits which is being given to them by Nasruddin al-Tusi. This Nasruddin al-Tusi, he was one of the ministers of Al-Khalifa al-Abbasi, and he have sold him very cheap, and he betrayed him, and he cooperated with the Mongols until that Khalifa was killed, and the whole family was taken booty, and the whole of Baghdad was booty for the Mongols and the Tatars. That is a scenario from the Shia. They will always cooperate against Sunni Muslims, as they have done in the time of Salah ad-Din al-Ayyubi, and they have cooperated with the Christians against Sunni Muslims until Salah ad-Din al-Ayyubi had known that he has to fight them before he even fight the Christians. Just recently, when the Lebanon accepted the Shia madhab after the after Khomeini established in Iran, he started propagating his poison here and there. And the same very land which was anti-Shia, Syria and Lebanon, which was in the hand of Muawiyah radiallahu anhu, it became Shia itself. And many of us have seen when these people accept Shiaism in the South Lebanon, they have cooperated with Jews against Sunni Muslims. And if you don't believe me, in the beginning of this tape, just before I started my speech, I have put the introduction to that. Pictures and clips is taken by Christians showing how Shia invited Jews, how when Jews, Israelis went inside Lebanon, they were clapping, giving them roses, welcoming them inside Lebanon, and trapping the whole Sunni Muslims under the fire of Israelis, and they were only confronted with the Israelis when the Israelis decided to stay because of land, not because of Aqidah. That is the Shia. All the time they will cooperate against Sunni Muslims. Their fiqh is simply find what the Sunni do and do the opposite. This is the fiqh of the Shia. Just find what the Sunni will do and just do the opposite. And if you read their books of fiqh, you will laugh to your ears. So it is very serious to consider them as a part from Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. In fact, they are not a part of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. Some Shia are secular. They do not know about the religion. And they think just because they have to be called Shia to support Imam Ali. And the word Shia is just to support Imam Ali. And if you are not Shia, you are against Imam Ali and you are out of Islam. Those people are tricked. We are talking here about the criminal Shia who knows what does it take to become a Shia. And they curse the Sahaba, and they don't believe in the that the Quran is complete, and they always cooperate against Ahlul Sunnah al-Jama'ah due to hatred to the religion and to the Sahaba. That introduction is important because many people say that we are doing fitna. We are not doing fitna, we are just trying to educate people about Shia as they are going like poison. Even when we went to Bosnia, the people were busy fighting and the Shia was giving their poison da'wah to the Hanafi people. Although the Shia call Imam Abu Hanifa kafir, the Shia they call Imam Abu Hanifa kafir, and this is in their books. Although Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah is the student of Ja'far al-Sadiq from Ahlul Bayt, but they still call him a kafir. And they call the six books of Hadith kafir. They call Bukhari, Muslim, Tirmizi, Ibn Majah, Ibn Nisa'i, they call all them kafir. Why not if they call all the Sahaba kafir? This is from their books and this is their aqidah and this is their mazhab. And they don't see how to pray behind Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah unless they make intention inside that they are praying differently from them. However, this is their aqidah. But unfortunately, some of them, they hide their aqidah, but they show the true colors when they are in power. But before we do talk about the Shia and some of their mazhab, let us see the history of the Shia. How did they start? Because knowing how did they start, you will be astonished where they get all these crazy ideas about. The word Shia, it means a supporter. In the language, it means supporter. And the word Shia in Islam is being used even in the Quran, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَمِن شِيَعَتِهِ وَإِنَّ مِن شِيَعَتِهِ لَإِبْرَاهِيمِ. That the supporters of one of the prophets is the supporters of Ibrahim, the descender and the supporter of Ibrahim. And also said about Musa, فَاسْتَغَاثَهُ الَّذِي مِن شِيَعَتِهِ عَلَى الَّذِي مِن عَدُوِهِ عَلَيْكُمْ السَّلَامِ. That the Shia of Musa, which is the branch of the supporters of Musa, he asked Musa to help him against his enemy. So Shia means the supporter, it means the branch, means the allied. It could be mean that. This is why the Shia hide behind these names, so they can catch with simple-minded Muslims, but they are using them badly. How did the start of the Shia in theory, and how did they start practically? It's something which we have to focus. When Islam have spread in the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, who was very busy fighting the apostates, he didn't have much time to actually fight the Romans and the other. To expand the Islamic state. But then Umar radiallahu anhu, the Khilafah of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, stayed 2.5 years. Umar radiallahu anhu, it stayed 9.5 years. Within the time of Umar, after the apostasy had damped down, then it was the conquering of Iran, Iraq, and Egypt, and all this. And it was the expansion of the Islamic state was really terrifying. Terrifying to the fire worshippers, which is the Majus, the fathers of the Iranians and the originals of the Shias, and actually in Egypt even the Romans. So there was no, after the destruction of the two big empires, which is the Persian Empire, the Romans Empire, there was no hope to stop Islam externally. There was just no hope. The whole country was swollen like a hot toast. Nobody could stop against the army of the Muslims. And the hatred from Jews who have been kicked in the time of Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu, applying the wasiyah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam that there should be no more Jews in the peninsula, he refused to renew the extension for the Jews to stay in the peninsula, and he kicked him out of the peninsula to go somewhere in Sham or some other places. Now there was no Jews in the area. Now there is no fire worshipper in the area unless they are slaves. If they are slaves, if they are bought with money, or if they are taking booties, then they only allow to stay in this kind of area as slaves. However, but Jews and fire worshipper will not just leave their empires like that. So the only way to damage is to accept Islam in hypocrisy. There was a person who had three reasons to hate Islam and three reasons to fight Islam. His name was Abdullah ibn Sabah, ibn Sauda. He was a Jew. So he hated Islam because he's a Jew and he's seen what happened to the Jewish in the Muslim hands. And he was also black from Yemen. And Yemen was also had some control from Persia. The Persian used to control Yemen, and the fire worshippers used to control Yemen. And Yemen was also swollen by the Muslim Empire, and he found himself he had nowhere to go. He lost his religion, he lost his family, he lost everything. And he started plotting against Islam. So he accepted Islam, this Abdullah ibn Sabah, and he decided the only way to stay in Islam is to announce his love to Ahlul Bayt, to the people of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the family of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he start saying the love of Ahlul Bayt, and he start singing with the love of Ahlul Bayt. That was in the time of Uthman. Before the time of Uthman comes, Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu, he was killed by a fire worshipper man. His name is Abu Lu'ah al-Majusi. He had seen in his dream radiallahu anhu that a cook had actually stabbed him twice in his stomach, and they told him that an non-Arab person will actually stab you twice in your stomach, and you will be killed for that. And this is what happened. Abu Lu'lu' al-Majusi, he was not a Muslim. He killed Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu out of his hatred, because he, Umar ibn Khattab, have done what he done to the fire worshippers of Iraq and Iran. And until today, the Shia are celebrating that day, the day which Abu Lu'lu' al-Majusi have killed Umar ibn Khattab, until today. And they call that feast, they call it what? Abu Shuja' al-Din, the father of the courageous religion, which is who? Abu Lu'lu' al-Majusi. So they love him because of his deen, and they love him because of his action. And what was his action? Is to kill the second Khalifa. Until now they celebrate that. They call it the feast of Abu Shuja' al-Din, which is the feast of Abu Lu'lu' al-Majusi, who killed Umar ibn Khattab. Just to show you how they go with their ignorance, even announce them, because they have a country now and they don't care much about their beliefs to be shown. However, after the second Khalifa radiallahu anhu was killed, Uthman stayed another 12 years of, mashallah, opening the Muslim land, and the wealth in the time of Uthman have been so big and so large, and every Muslim was happy. But there was some conflict about power, about being, you know, being a leader or being emir of some of these sub-states, and trying to please the Khalifa to give you some place and so on and so forth. Abdullah ibn Sabah, he started his game through that. Somebody put that. Abdullah ibn Sabah, he started playing his role now. How did he do that? He played it as every Jew will do it. Try to make a media, and to control a media, and to blackmail people because of this media, or through this media. How did he make the media? He had the hypocrites like himself to try to denounce Uthman. Uthman stayed 12 years in the Khilafah, and the last 3 years of the Khilafah of Uthman, these people have sent their supporters, the Jewish, which is our convert to Islam, and the fire worshippers, which are convert to Islam, to start politically attack Uthman radiallahu anhu, to say that he's giving power to his family, he's not distributing the wealth of Muslims correctly, and he's doing many mistakes. They used to send people to Iraq, to Basra and Kufa, and send people to Egypt. And with the hiding behind the love of Ahlul Bayt, the love of Imam Ali, and the love of some of the Sahaba, they wanted the Islamic State to be turbulence. And through 3 years, they have done a lot of damage. But they cannot unify everybody behind one person. So because they have sent the people to Iraq, so the people of Basra and the people of Kufa, they have said, oh, there is so many mistakes of Uthman, so we want to appoint Abdullah ibn Zubayr or Talha. The people of Egypt, they wanted to appoint, because they were the immediate followers of Abdullah ibn Sabah, they wanted to appoint Ali ibn Abi Talib to rule. So they wanted to make a revolution. Many of the people who are simple-minded have followed them. They did not know their agenda. Subhanallah. Then they have decided to go, they said, we're going to go in a hidden mission. We're claiming that we're going for Hajj. We will go from Basra, from Kufa in Iraq in the east, and from Egypt in the west, and we will go as we're going for Hajj and Umrah, and then we will surround the palace of Uthman. They have done this over 3 years of continuous propaganda against Uthman, that he is a wrongdoer, he's given the wealth of the Muslim state to his family. They have surrounded, suddenly they arrived to the Medina. The Medina is the capital of Islam. All the armies are outside fighting for Islam. The army of Sham, the army of this, the army of that. And the Sahaba never used to allow hypocrites to come to Medina. Suddenly they were on Medina, surrounding the palace of Uthman and threatening everybody. This man is a wrongdoer, and this man must be removed. Amongst them, there was some Sahaba fooled by them, but they didn't think it will come to that point. And some of the sons of the Sahaba, like Muhammad ibn Abi Bakr, the son of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, and he took part in killing Uthman afterwards. They have surrounded Medina, they said you have to remove that man. 10,000 people surrounded Medina. Nobody could do anything towards them politically. They said this man must be removed. The Sahaba, the people of Kufa, they said, we want you to remove Uthman. They said to Abdullah ibn Zubayr, people of Kufa and Basra, they said to Abdullah ibn Zubayr, they said to Zubayr ibn al-Awwam and to Talha, you must remove this man and we will give you bay'ah. The people of Egypt, they said to Ali radiallahu anhu, you must remove this man and we will give you bay'ah. None of these Sahaba accepted such a thing, and they find the Medina under the threats. 10,000 people right in Medina, they have hidden emirs, they have certain powers to push them here and there, and nobody can do anything from the Sahaba towards them. In the end of the day, Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu, he sent Hassan and al-Husayn to protect Uthman. Some of the Sahaba were protecting Uthman radiallahu anhu day and night. Until Uthman radiallahu anhu, he had seen in his dream, in his sleep, that he will see Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in that day. So he said to al-Hassan al-Husayn, you go now, you are not going to help me anymore. They said to him, you're going to be killed if we go. He said, do not worry, just go. So he forced them to go. He forced them to go. And Ammar ibn Yasir radiallahu anhu is one of the big supporters of Imam Ali. He actually carried water himself to Uthman to drink, because Uthman, he bought a well and he gave it to the Muslims when they were thirsty. So he said, how can I starve man of water? And he used to buy water for Muslims in their difficulties. However, he pushed him. He said, don't stay here. If these people want to kill, I don't want this situation to stay forever. If these people want to kill me, they're going to kill me eventually anyway. So they went. After they went, the people wanted to kill Uthman, to cause turbulence. Inside the Islamic State, they climbed the house of Uthman and they hold him from his beard. One of them was Muhammad ibn Abi Bakr. He said to him, your father, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, he used to respect this beard. He said, if my father was here, he would have killed you after what you've doing to us and the Ummah. Then his wife, her name was Naila, she have seen them, they're trying to kill him. Then she throw herself at him. Then they cut her fingers, because they were trying to stab Uthman radiallahu anhu into his stomach. Uthman was a fat person. Then they dragged him down, and then they tried to stab him in his stomach. Then she put her hand to stop the sword. They cut her fingers, and then in the end they slaughtered him, and his blood splashes all over the place, even into the Mus'haf of Uthman, the Quran of Uthman, which a copy of which is in the British Museum now taken. After Uthman was killed, nobody believed what happened. And the people who have killed him, they've realized they have done a big mistake, and everybody will go against them when this news will go. Because Uthman has been a relative. Uthman is the cousin of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ibn bint Amr Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Nobody knows what to do. Medina stayed without Khalifa for some times. The killers realize that they have done the damage. Now they want to protect themselves and they want to carry on. Some are astonished. The Sahaba, they don't know what to do. They don't know whom to punish. They don't know where to go. Medina is occupied by 10,000 criminals. Some of them are fools, just being fooled by the slogans and the political papers here and there. When this have happened, the cousin Muawiyah at this time, he was the ruler of whole Sham, which is Syria, Lebanon, and all this land. Syria, Lebanon, Palestine. He was the Amir of all that. When this have happened, the cousin of Uthman radiallahu anhu, he had taken his dress and he has taken the fingers of his wife to Muawiyah radiallahu anhu. And he said, look, this had happened in the time of when many Sahaba are there, and they did not want to help Uthman, and from here the fitna started. The people, the 10,000 people who have committed this crime, they realize if the Khalifa comes from anybody other than the one they have appointed, they will all be killed. And it's a matter of time. They have decided not to be separated. They have decided not to go to their own homeland and origins before they appoint a Khalifa who will cover up for their crime. They went to Abdullah ibn Zubayr. They said to him, listen, we must give you bay'ah. He said, no way, I'm going to give you, you are the killers of Uthman, how can I give you bay'ah? They went to Talha, you must. He said, no, I can't. Then they went to Ali, he said, no way, I can't. What do I tell people if I give you bay'ah, if you give me bay'ah, if I accept bay'ah from you? It is not for you anyway to give me bay'ah. The bay'ah is for the people of Badr. If the people of Badr give me bay'ah, then okay, nothing to do with you. Situation stayed like that. They had a meeting together and they said, I'm quoting you from some of the books of the Shia, from Al-Ya'qubi, from Al-Mas'udi, from their own books. I'm not quoting from Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, although this matches also the stories of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. The early Shia were much honest than the late Shia. However, they've decided if these people do not choose the Khalifa, situation can be worse, and maybe Muawiyah will come and other people will come from Iraq and they will take over the thing and they will appoint the Khalifa which you have nothing to do with him, and we will be in a dilemma. So they give warning to the people of Medina. They said, if you do not appoint a Khalifa from these people which Uthman, which Zubayr or Talha or Ali, if you do not appoint a Khalifa from these people within 3 days, we will take over Medina and we will do for Medina as we do for a non-Muslim city, because you cannot stay without a Khalifa for more than 3 days. So they play with these games. When this have happened, some Sahaba tried to escape, they failed, they could not escape. Then they offered Ali ibn Abi Talib, they said, look, you are the relative of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and then why don't you keep the blood of the Ummah and carry on and do this and do that. So he accepted their bay'ah. His son Al-Hasan radiallahu anhu, he said, don't take their bay'ah, don't take their bay'ah now, you will suffer from it the whole time of your Khilafah. He said, if we don't do this, they will go and get somebody else and give him bay'ah. He said, does it matter, leave them. They will go here left and right and they will find nobody but you, and then you will be given the bay'ah. So Ali radiallahu anhu, he understood that if he left that thing in this situation, then there was a threat for Islam, disintegration of Islam and divisions among his Muslims. All the family of Imam Ali have told them, don't accept the bay'ah from these killers now, because that will not unify the Ummah. Indeed, he accepted the bay'ah. That was his ijtihad, radiallahu anhu. He is capable. Nobody after Uthman is to be trusted with the Ummah more than Imam Ali. But the problem is the political situation, that it is after the murdering of the Khalifa. And it will look for people that the one who will accept bay'ah after him, he has something to do with his blood. And this is exactly what has happened. He accepted the bay'ah. If you go to the books of the Shia, what was the first khutbah before he accepted the bay'ah? In their book which is called Nahjul Balagha, one of the main books of the Shia, when they went to Imam Ali to ask him for a bay'ah, he said, da'uni wal tamisu ghayri, leave me alone and get somebody else. If he was appointed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he cannot say that. If it's a matter of aqidah, he cannot say that. And this is in their books, it's not in our books. This is in their books. However, when they force him, because of the Medina could be booty for these 10,000 people, when they force him, they said, okay, if you give me bay'ah, then you must do this and you must do that, otherwise I have nothing to do with your bay'ah. And this is also from the books of Shia, Nahjul Balagha. Nahjul Balagha is the khutbahs of Imam Ali, his khutbah, which is in a very nice, clear Arabic language. And they are very proud of this book, although in his book he's swearing at them, he's exposing them. So he, if he was appointed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and it's compulsory for him to become the Khalifa, he wouldn't have told them, I will reject your bay'ah if you are not helping me in this and you are not helping me in that. I ask everybody to read the khutbah, the first khutbah of Imam Ali, karam Allah wajhu wa radiyallahu anhu, when he was appointed as a Khalifa, and to see it for anybody who understands the Arabic language or even have any sense of humor to know that this person is taking this Khilafah and it is not compulsory on him and he hates it most. And he is very ready to give it back at any time. So it's not compulsory for him. However, once he accepted Khilafah, once he accepted their bay'ah, they said to the Sahaba, you have to go and do bay'ah, all of you. Then Zubayr ibn al-Awwam and Talha refused. He said, how can we give bay'ah to a man and the people who give him bay'ah are the killers of our Khalifa? How can we give them bay'ah? They said, if you do not give them bay'ah, he will simply kill you. Then they went, Talha went and he gave bay'ah. He said, but I am forced to give bay'ah, but I did give bay'ah. Zubayr, he said the same. He said, I'm forced to give bay'ah, but I did give bay'ah. So they gave him bay'ah and straight away they run to Iraq. After they give bay'ah, they run to Iraq. They run to Al-Kufa and Al-Basra, which was, they have a lot of supporters there. Iraq. They run to Iraq. And Sayyidah Aisha, she also ran to Iraq because she was very frustrated. Many people frustrated. How come the people who killed Uthman, they get away with their murder and they appoint the Khalifa and they threaten the Khalifa and they threaten Medina and they make the Sahaba to give bay'ah by force and nobody knows where they're coming from and who's moving them. But Imam Ali, he was playing politics as well with them. As soon as he became the Khalifa, people tell them, now you must get the blood of Uthman. You must see who killed Uthman and the blood must be paid and he should be punished. Then he said to them, look at them, there are 10,000 people, how can we do it? That will never go out of my mind, I will always hunt for the blood of Uthman radiallahu anhu. But this is not the time for it. Then he sent some of the Sahaba to the origin of these people. He sent Ammar ibn Yasir to Egypt to see where these people come from. They came from a village which is called Khirbitha in Egypt, where the Jews have accepted Islam and they've hidden their names, they've hidden their aqidah, and they start giving charity to people like they're doing now. They're doing now in their organizations, the human rights and all this. They were helping people and recruiting people, and they couldn't find anything of Ammar. He said, radiallahu anhu, he said, they are from the best people. Again, they sent people to Basra, they sent people to Iraq, and they could not find. They said they are from among the best people, because they adopted their policy that to show Islam and to hide their hypocrisy. The advice from Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu to Ali ibn Abi Talib, he said to him, now I know what you're going to do. The first thing you're going to tell to Muawiyah, you leave Sham and I am appointing somebody else and give me bay'ah. You should not do this at the time. So Imam Ali radiallahu anhu, he said, no, the truth must become truth. I am the Khalifa, I am giving the bay'ah, and I want Muawiyah to leave his place now. Obviously, that was not a very wise thing to do politically, because Muawiyah, he wanted the blood for his relative, which is Uthman, which is the Khalifa, and also he doesn't want to leave the chair. He's a human being, although he's a Sahabi radiallahu anhu, but this is the very bad time to leave the chair. You leave the chair at this time, you could be killed as well. When 10,000 people are making Khalifa and giving bay'ah, that and Muawiyah, he is very clever as well. So when the news came to Muawiyah, leave your place and give bay'ah to Imam Ali and somebody else will be on Sham, then the things have become really crumbling. Then Muawiyah refused and he said, no, I cannot give bay'ah to a Khalifa who have been given bay'ah by the killers of his predecessor. This is not Islamic and this is not even politic. And I am defying this order and I don't believe that you are a legitimate Khalifa. And I'm not going to give you bay'ah. You can't be a Khalifa and your army is the killers of Uthman. However, so Imam Ali, he said, if you don't do this, then I'll have to get an army for you. The people who give Imam Ali bay'ah and they run to Iraq in the other side, which is Zubayr and and the Talha. They have also collected their supporters, which some of them are, many of them are the Sahaba, the deceased Sahaba, like Al-Qa'qa ibn Amr and many of the Sahaba. Some Sahaba stayed with the Imam Ali, and some stayed with Aisha, and some stayed with Muawiyah. So Aisha radiallahu anha, she joined forces with Muawiyah radiallahu anhum, that we must, before we decide who is going to be the Khalifa, we must first get rid of these 10,000 people who have killed Uthman, and they are a part of the army of Ali. And how can Ali radiallahu anhu accept that these are part of his army? And this is the dilemma comes. Subhanallah. Fitna. But this is what happened. So Imam Ali, he wanted to go to Iraq to reconciliate with the people of Iraq, after the Zubair and the Talha have gone there. So what he said, he sent some people. He sent Al-Qa'qa ibn Amr from Aisha radiallahu anha, and Imam Ali, he sent one of his followers to talk. If I am the Khalifa, why you don't open me? Why don't you obey me? Why you have given me bay'ah and now you have gone to Iraq? And then the other people start talking. Then the appointee of Imam Ali, he assured the people of Iraq at this time with the Sayyidah Aisha that as soon as the matter will settle, the killers of Uthman, they will be punished, and severely punished. And they came to agreement. They came to agreement. And the Muslims, they loved it. That mashallah, they were going to join force with Imam Ali. They had nothing to do that Imam Ali is a Khalifa. No, they were not upset about that. All what they upset, that these dirty 10,000 people in the army of Imam Ali. So both of them, the soldiers of the followers of Zubair ibn al-Awam and Talha and Sayyidah Aisha, they have and the soldiers of Imam Ali, they have decided to come near. He goes from Medina and they come from Iraq, and to meet somewhere near each other and start the negotiations, what they're going to do. And in fact, they have decided the conditions of reconciliation, that they will join forces together, and then they will ask Muawiyah to go and join forces as well in Sham. After they finish their problem in Iraq together, they will go to Muawiyah and try to solve the problem politically. But the Muslims were very happy that the problems between Medina and Iraq will finish. And it was the next morning, the time they should meet together. At this night, Abdullah ibn Saba' ibn Sawda' and his followers, they said, this is it. These people will not come together unless they have decided what they're going to do with us. And if that night passes without we do anything, that means we're going to be killed in the next night. What shall we do? And after Isha, they stay talking until near Fajr. And the two camps are very close to each other, because they will not worry about each other. They are many of them are Sahaba, and they are not traitors, and they never betray each other. Then before Fajr, these people have decided the only chance we have is to make war between these people. And they've decided to do that. So some of them, they've decided that to stay, some of them, they stay next to the big leaders. Some of them, they stay next to Imam Ali. He could be killed at any time if things do not work right. Some they stay next to Al-Zubair, some they stay next to Talha. They had people in the two parties, because don't forget they came from Basra and Kufa originally. So some of them they were staying and some were doing their politic parts there in Basra, which they have given support to Al-Zubair and Talha when they escaped from their other partners in Medina. And the plan was just that. And before Fajr, they attacked. They start attacking the people of Jaish, which is Sayyidah Aisha, are there, and they start killing the people of the army of Imam Ali as well. And they shouted themselves, "We've been betrayed! This khawana, khawana, khawana!" And everybody got into his sword, and it was the war. They went originally to reconcile. They went originally to finish the problem in peace. And before the midday comes up, there were 5,000 killed from each party. 10,000 people were killed in Mawta'at al-Jamal. And the Jamal, which is the camel of Sayyidah Aisha radiallahu anha, was his legs were chopped off and brought and Ammar ibn Yasir was saying here, are you happy our mother of Islam now to see your children killing each other? And it was a big fitna. In the end of the day, Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu, he said, you should have stayed in Medina, you shouldn't have gone there and this and that. And then they buried all the Sahaba. From 10,000 Sahabi have been killed in this Tabi'i and Sahabi in this Mawqa'at al-Jaman. Then he took her back, he sent her back to Medina, and he started preparing to go and fight with Muawiyah radiallahu anhu. But at this time, these murderers survived. These, they call themselves Shia, survived. Then they done the same similar trick with Muawiyah radiallahu anhu, and it was much easier with Muawiyah because Muawiyah had other reasons as well than the blood of Uthman, that he doesn't want to leave Sham. He doesn't want to leave the leadership of Sham as well, and he did not recognize Ali to become the Khalifa, and he did not give him the bay'ah because he knows if he gave him the bay'ah, he will leave Sham as well. So it becomes very easier. Then the fight with Sufyan with Muawiyah radiallahu anhu and Ali radiallahu anhu, it happened, and then Imam Ali went back to Iraq. He decided to have his headquarters in Iraq because there was many supporters for him there. But again, as we did talk about the Khawarij, the Shia and the Khawarij, they were both enemies to Imam Ali. The Khawarij, they hated Imam Ali, and the Shia, or the people who claimed they give victory to Imam Ali at this time, they were working against him. Even in their books, in Nahj al-Balagha, here he said, Imam Ali, that you people are supporting me. I wish that Muawiyah will give me one man of his, and I'll give him 10 of you. One man of his, and I'll give you 10 of you. 10 of his. 10 of you. Because they have supported him in his wrongdoing, and you have deceived me in my truth. Because you know, there was a trick happened between the people, the followers of, between Imam Ali and Muawiyah, when Imam Ali appointed somebody, Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, and Muawiyah appointed Amr ibn al-As, and Amr ibn al-As tricked Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, and that resulted that the Khawarij came and they fought Imam Ali, and they caused a lot of trouble for him, even when he was quarreling with Muawiyah. In the khutbahs, during this quarrel, Muawiyah radiallahu anhu, sometimes he used to curse Imam Ali. But Imam Ali radiallahu anhu, karamallahu wajhu, he never cursed Muawiyah. And this is their books, if you see their books, in their books, in their tariq, they said that Ali radiallahu anhu, he never cursed Muawiyah. He used to say that these people, we fight them, they think they are right and we think we are right. And we fight them for that. He never cursed them, he never called them kafirs, he never called them bid'is, he never called them anything. The Sahaba in the camp of Imam Ali, the Sahaba in the camp of Muawiyah, they never cursed each other. They used to fight in the morning, and in the evening they cry and bury each other. This is in their books as well, in their tariq as well. When Imam Ali finds that his Shia is deceiving him all the time and all the way, he did give up with them. In the end, the Khawarij killed Imam Ali. And Muawiyah becomes stronger and stronger. But the supporters of Imam Ali, or the so-called supporters of Imam Ali after receiving so many battles, they did not leave Al-Hasan alone. Al-Hasan, the son of Imam Ali, they said, we give you bay'ah. So they give him bay'ah for 6 months. Al-Hasan radiallahu anhu, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, this is my son. He's a master. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reconciliate through him with two big believers group, with two big groups of the believers. And this had happened. Al-Hasan knew this hadith. That was a hint from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, saying to Al-Hasan that when you grow up, sacrifice your right to unify the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he remembered this hadith, because this hadith said, innahu minni, is my son, and he's from me, and he's a master, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make him a reason to reconciliate between two big groups. And this is what happened. So Al-Hasan, before before he made the reconciliation, he didn't want to be a leader. And he knew that the people who give his father support by mouth, they will defeat him. Then he started exhorting them. He said, you want to fight Muawiyah? He said, yeah. You want to go for that? He said, yeah. He said, okay, I'm going to take you. So he took them out of Basra, out of Iraq. He took them to the camping area where he's going to camp. And he have tested them. And he have seen them always giving him trouble. And then he made istikhara to leave the whole matter to Muawiyah. And to put the Muslims in Aam al-Jama'ah, on the year of Jama'ah, which they all conciliate. He made istikhara, and he collected, he said, I want to give you a very important talk. This is in their books, Al-Mas'udi Shi'i, he's from Shia, and he writes only history. Then he said to them, you have given my father trouble. And until now you're giving me trouble. And I do not think you're going to last if I fight Muawiyah. I don't think you will last fighting with me. So what do you think if one day I find that the right for all Muslims that person will rule? Then they jumped, then he managed to escape. They ran after him. They took his clothes. They stabbed him also on his side. He was bleeding badly. They took one of his girls as booty, not daughters. They took Jariya from him as booty, and they stripped the whole of his tent. They took even his qamis. He managed to escape by some of the very sincere followers of him. This is what they're doing today, son of Rasulullah. This is their Shia. Nothing to do with Sham. All this is happening in Iraq, in Shia, in the supporters or the people who cry for Ahlul Bayt. They are the first to kill Ahlul Bayt. And that was the first time the word Islam and Kufr comes with regard to that political thing. That they say to Al-Hassan, you have become a kafir, a mushrik like your father, for you to leave all this, to leave the hukm and the khilafah for Muawiyah. He escaped Al-Hassan and he was treated from his wounded, and he said to Muawiyah, he said, I will leave you the matter, but you must promise that you will judge Muslim according to the khilafah. According to the four caliphs, Abu Bakr, wa Umar, wa Uthman, wa Ali, and this is a condition. And if you fear for yourself that you're not going to do this, leave it. And I don't want to be a Khalifa for Muslims. He stayed Khalifa only for 6 months. That is to continue the 30 years of Khilafa, what Rasulullah SAW said, the Khilafa Rashida is 30 years. After that, it's kingdom. This hadith is narrated by Imam Ahmad. This is what happened. Then Muawiyah and the sincere Sahaba, they became very happy, and they call it Aam al-Jama'ah, the year which all the Sahaba came together, and Muawiyah with a Khalifa at the time. And these people were furious and they run everywhere. When Muawiyah radiallahu anhu died, and Al-Hasan was poisoned, and here again we ask ourselves, who poisoned Al-Hassan? The most person who would like Al-Hassan to stay alive and to protect him is Muawiyah. Because Al-Hassan all the time, he was with Muawiyah helping him for the Khilafah and killing every fitna that anybody challenging Muawiyah for the kingdom, for his kingdom, for the Muslims to become united again and they start fighting the Romans and start fighting the Hindus and start fighting the people here and there. So if anybody on earth was keen for Al-Hassan to stay alive, is Muawiyah. And the Shia, they say Muawiyah have poisoned him. How come he poisoned? The minute Al-Hassan was poisoned, Al-Hussein was provoked, radiallahu anhu, by the former supporter of his father and Al-Hassan. They said, we are all yours. Go and take the Khilafah, because Muawiyah now has died. So they put a question mark that these Shia have always plotted against Ahlul Bayt and they wanted to go for the turbulence for the Islamic State. And the fingers point towards them that they have poisoned Al-Hassan because of what he done. They have tried to kill him before. They've called him a kafir, a mushrik, and they take his belongings as booty. And he was not treated like that from Muawiyah. Muawiyah did give him. We do believe that the right is with Imam Ali. We do believe that. And I bear witness, if I was in the time of Imam Ali, we would have been in his side. But there's a difference that for a man is right politically and to call everybody else a kafir. The Sahaba, they supported Imam Ali politically without calling anybody else who was his enemy as a kafir. However, when they both died, Imam Hussein is being provoked because the son of Muawiyah Yazid, he was not all that good, and there was many complaints about him, and certainly Al-Husayn is much better than him on the sight of the Sahaba, on the sight of the Tabi'een, on the sight of anybody who knows about Islam. But the problem is Yazid, he's got the sword, he's got the power. And the Mazhab of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah and the Sahaba understand that if somebody is wrongdoer and he's got the power, then as long as he's not a kafir, then you cannot go and fight him, because the Muslims will have a conflict among themselves. Then Ibn Mas'ud, Ibn Abbas, he advised him. He got a message, Al-Husayn got a message from the people of Iraq. Come to us. You've got here no less than 18,000 people waiting for you. Who sent him this message? The one who sent him his message, his name is Muslim ibn Uqayl ibn Abi Talib, his cousin, the cousin of Al-Husayn. Very sincere person. But the people who were around him, they were the former supporter of Imam Ali and Al-Hasan, which they don't keep a word. He said, 18,000 people are waiting for you. So come to Iraq, we'll support you. Then Al-Husayn, he collected his family and he was prepared to go to Iraq. Then Ibn Abbas stopped him. He said, where are you going? He said, I'm going to Iraq. He said, what are you doing? Going to Iraq to do what? He said, I'm going there. I'm going to bring the Khilafah to the house of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, but you are mistaken. You are going to the same very people who have killed your father because of anger, and you have tried to kill physically your brother. What are you trying to do? This is, if you have a peace of mind, you should not go there. If you want to go there, if you want these people to be sincere, if you want to check their sincerity, go to Yemen. You have many supporters in Yemen. And if these people in Iraq are sincere, tell them, catch up with me in Yemen, I'll see you in Yemen. If they go out of their homes, at least they will be sincere. But you go to them, and you announce your enmity to Yazid, and then you put yourself in confrontation, they will leave you. They will not support you. Then he did not listen to him. He carried on. He has seen many people in the way advise him, you are the son of Rasulullah, don't do this, don't do that. These people are deceivers. These people cannot keep a word. And their past has shown what is going to happen in the future. When the news came that Al-Husayn is coming, is going to them, the news seeped out to Yazid in Sham. So he sent his order for the wali of Al-Basra to step down to somebody is called Ziyad, Ibn Ziyad. That Ibn Ziyad is a very crafty person. The news came also to the existing ruler of Al-Basra in Iraq that Al-Husayn is coming and his supporters are waiting for him. So everybody was waiting for Al-Husayn at this time. And here Ziyad has come, which is appointed by Yazid. Ibn Ziyad has come, and he put the imamah of Ahl al-Bayt, the black imamah, and he went and he covered his face and he pretended that he's from Ahl al-Bayt, and everybody was saying, Oh Al-Husayn, Yabdi bint Rasulullah, your grandson of Rasulullah, your grandson of Rasulullah. And he was sharing them up like that. Until he went to the palace or the house of the ruler of the time, then he said to him, you are the son of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Why did you choose my city from amongst all these cities to make a terrible sin to it? Why did you come here? And he said to him, no, I am Ziyad, I am Ibn Ziyad. I've been sent by Yazid to take over from you. Open the door, you fool. Then he opened the door for him and he went. Then they were plotting against Al-Husayn. However, Ibn Ziyad, he's got his soldiers, and before Al-Husayn come, he attacked the supporters, the houses of the supporters of Al-Husayn. And he killed one of their scholars. He tortured him and he killed him. When this news happened, when this news was heard, then the cousin of Al-Hussein, Muslim ibn Uqayl ibn Abi Talib, he provoked the people. He said, Al-Hussein will come and we must now take over the whole city. And when he come, he see us in control. They said, okay, no problem. And they had a secret word among them, which is called Mansur. They said, okay, Mansur. 18,000 people after that word Mansur, they collected 18,000 people. And they said, now we are 18,000 people. Now we march to the palace of the ruler of Ibn Ziyad. So he did march with them. These 18,000 people, by the time they went to the palace of the ruler, they were only 100,000. They start the march, and everybody remembered that his wife was pregnant and his mother-in-law, she's cooking for him tonight, and he has some problem and he had to see this and he had to do that. By the time they reached the gate, this is from their books, there were only 100 people. By the time they entered the gate, he was him and two. And when he was gone about to knock the door, he was alone. And before the door opened, he ran himself. And everybody was looking for him because he was the head of the fitna, they call it. And in the end, some Bedouin, he told about him and he was killed. All that happened and Al-Hussein is in the way. Everybody in the city is waiting for Al-Hussein. But they cannot raise a sword. The 18,000 people who promised him to come, we will protect you, they are all staying for him, watching what is going to happen to them. He came, Al-Hussein. He find no supporters. He came with the family of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And as he come, the people of Medina, they went outside, the people of Iraq, they went outside, not to support him, to see what is going to happen to him. And he was surrounded by all these fans, as you see in the football supporters, and the soldiers of Ziyad, Ibn Ziyad, which is the appointee of Yazid in Sham. Not one single soldier has come from Sham. All the soldiers who have killed Al-Hussein and his family, they were all from the Shia land, from Iraq. All from them. Then as soon as he come, Ibn Ziyad, this Khabith, he start fighting and he wanted to kill him. Al-Hussein, he seen no supporters. But he was not a coward to go back. When he see the people coming to a fight, he said, take me to Ziyad, because we are relatives. Take me to Ziyad. They refused to take him to Ziyad. And he was killed. In the front of his Shia, in the front of the supporters, and they were crying, but nobody dares to raise the sword for him. Nobody wants to go and share him even his destiny. Whom they invited him for it. Not one single soldier from Muawiyah have killed him. Not one single soldier from Yazid have killed him. They are all soldiers from Iraq. Some of them were even his supporters to kill him. Then they were all taken. After they killed him, they start praying, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad, in their prayer. Then in the family of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they took him right, they went inside Iraq, and they have seen everybody is wailing. And the daughters of Al-Hussein, she was crying, you are people of Iraq crying for our kill, and you have killed us. Who killed us but you? We've been staying in Medina. Who have killed us but you? But you, Shia. That is the story of the Shia from their books. And until now, not aware of kufr, not aware that Muawiyah is a kafir, or Yazid is a kafir, all political thing for the chair, just for the chair. Some they do it fi sabilillah, others they do it for other than sabilillah. This is the story of what happened to the Shia. And after that, the Shia start getting extreme because they've been forced by the sword. After the killing of Al-Hussein, somebody else tried to fight Yazid, which is Abdullah ibn Zubayr ibn al-Awam, the son of Ibn Zubayr ibn al-Awam. He was fighting Yazid in Medina, and he was given bay'ah as a khalifa in Medina, and they fought him for so many times. He is the son of Asma bint Abi Bakr, radiallahu anha. And he was killed, and his body was hanged for 3 days. Yazid have done a lot of wrongs Some scholars they curse him. Some they call him a kafir because of his action against the Sahaba, not because of action against Ahlul Bayt. He have killed the supporters of Imam Ali, and he have killed the people who fought Imam Ali for the chair. So that is the political situation and the background of Shia, of Shiaism. Then he sent Al-Hajjaj, which is the Safah, the bloodthirsty, cursed person, قَبَّحَهُ اللَّهُ. He was a scholar, memorizer of the Quran, a professional scholar, a faqih. But he was a murderer. Then they sent him to Iraq. And because that he said his famous speech, أهل العراق يا أهل النفاق, people of Iraq, you are a people of nifaq. Because he knows they are traitors. They support you and they kill you. He said, by Allah, if I order one of you to go out of one of the doors of the mosque and he goes out of another door, I will chop his head. When I tell you go out of one door, you don't use another door, you use the same door. And he was treating them like slaves. And then Iraq was dumbed down. Then they start transferring their hatred to call the enemies of Imam Ali takfir, kuffar. Because this idea came from Abdullah ibn Saba. He would start talking about it even in the time of Imam Ali. But nobody listened to him. Nobody listened to him. He started saying the love of the Ahlul Bayt, the love of Ahlul Bayt, and then people followed him. And then some of them said, oh, because you love Ahlul Bayt, if you don't give them bay'ah, then you have taken the right, then you have become, then you are not a Muslim. Imam Ali have sent him where? He have sent him to Mada'in. He sent him to the where he come from, the places where the with the firewood shipper. But when Imam Ali died, then he start making his bid'ah among the fools there, and he start telling them that Imam Ali did not die. He did not die, he's still alive. Allah took him above the heaven, and the thunder is his sound. The thunder is his wit. And the sound of the rain is his sound. And he's still alive. Some didn't even believe him in that. So this is what the Shia start talking slowly, slowly about the Aqidah, but nobody have believed him. This is why Ahlul Sunnah al-Jama'ah, they have divided the Shia into four categories. One is the Shia supporters, which is ourselves, the people who support Imam Ali, without saying that he's better than the Sahaba or cursing or doing anything. Which is most of the supporters of Imam Ali was from that thing. Ammar ibn Yasir, Salman al-Farisi, all of them, they have given bay'ah before to Abu Bakr Siddiq and Umar ibn Khattab and Uthman ibn Affan. For 24 years, they didn't do anything against them. They were very loyal to them. Even Imam Ali himself, he was very loyal to him. Check what Imam Ali have said about Umar ibn Khattab himself and about Abu Bakr Siddiq in his books. In his khutbah, Nahj al-Balagha, when he said that Umar ibn Khattab is a person, Allah protect the religion for him. When Umar ibn Khattab asked him, shall I go with to fight the Romans myself with my army? He said, no, because if you get killed there, the army will be defeated and the Muslims will have a catastrophic. Stay here. If your Amir there gets killed, at least you become a protector for Muslims. So he was not cheetah. And he was not using tukya. But their words are conflicting with each other. Ahlul Sunnah al-Jama'ah words don't conflict with each other. Alhamdulillah. So after the death of these people, and when there is the people of Yazid and the people of Bani Umayyah are put in butchers like Al-Hajjaj, then these germs of Aqidah start emerging. And they start making these divisions among themselves. And they have been divided into many groups. So we said, Al-Sunnah al-Jama'ah, we said the first group is the people who are supporters of Imam Ali politically, but they never said that he's better than Abu Bakr Siddiq or Umar. The second group are people who are saying, no, he's better than Abu Bakr Siddiq, who believe that and Umar, he should be the Khalifa, but we don't curse them. And these are minority. The third group from the Shia, are the Shia Saba'iyya, which is the follower of Abdullah ibn Saba' at the beginning of his time, when he just came showing that he paid respect to the family of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam without
without claiming that Ali is God. And these are the Sab'iyya in their early days. They have divided into 39 groups. These people used to say that Imam Ali is better, and they used to curse the followers of Abdullah ibn Sabah. This is why Imam Ali have kicked him out to Madain. Some of his followers in their late days, after he was kicked to Madain, then they followed him there. Then in, when he was in Madain, far from Imam Ali, he said to him, shall I tell you something? He is God. Then when they came back, these fools, they were eating in Ramadan. Then Ali ibn Abi Talib was passing. He said, did you lose Ramadan? He said, yes. And they, he said, are you Muslim? He said, yes. He said, why are you eating Ramadan then? He said, it's you tell us when to eat when you are God. He said, what? He said, you are God. He said, by Allah, I will torture you as I never tortured anybody else. Then he dig the trenches for them. And he said to one of the Sahaba, if you don't repent, just set them a fire in the trench. And he burned them. Then the rest escaped. Until he died, radiallahu anhu, then they start whispering to Muslims, you know he's God, you know he's God, you know he's this, this, this. And this becomes the fourth category of Shia, which is Shia al-Ghula, the two extreme Shia, which is they call it Imam Ali God. And these themselves have divided into 19 groups. This is the start after, in the time of Yazid, after the Sahaba, and after Muawiyah radiallahu anhu, after Imam Ali, then these extreme Shia talk start, they start coming and they start giving their poison and they start cursing loudly the Sahaba and they start making their ideas and they start learning about Ahl Sunnah al-Jama'ah fiqh and they differ, deliberately differ from that and they start building their kufr. But the early Shia of Imam Ali, they used to bury each other when they fight with Muawiyah. They used to cry. They used to love the Amul Jama'ah. They called the Amul Jama'ah all together. But this was the hatred in the Shia times. The Shia is divided into 124 groups. 124 groups. What is known now, all these groups are Kafir groups, without any reservation. The only group which was not a Kafir, which is Shia al-Zaydiyya. Shia al-Zaydiyya, they have some of Shia-ism and Mu'tazili-ism. They have also the Mu'tazili. Some Shia are Khawarij, they are Shia and Khawarij. Some are Shia and Murji'ah. Some are Shia and Mu'tazili, because they mix with their bid'ahs, you see. And this is something you have to know. And the grandson of Imam Ali, his name was As-Sajjad. اسمه علي بن الحسين بن علي بن زين العابدين because the imam is the 12 imams is like that. Anyway, that son he has two that imam he has two children. One of them was called Muhammad al-Baqir and the other one was called Zayd ibn Muhammad al-Baqir. And this is where the Zaydiyya come from, that he used to think that Ali is better than Abu Bakr and Umar, which is not his brother view, which is not Al-Husayn view, which is not his father view or grandfather view. However, he used to think that, but he never used to curse them. And when the Shia of his time, they say, why don't you curse them? Then he said, I cannot curse them. I can only say, I believe that my grandfather is better than them. He should be the first Khalifa. But when he refused to curse them, he rejected him. This is why one of the other reasons, as I said in the beginning, they were called the rejectors. Because they rejected even the person who yielded a bit towards them. So how the Shia, they split? They split because of their policy. Who should be the Imam after the first Imam? The big one, sometimes they choose him as the big one. Like we choose Imam Al-Hasan. Sometimes they choose him the youngest one, like they choose Musa Al-Kazim. Son of Muhammad al-Baqir had six children. They didn't choose the big one, they just choose the youngest one, which is Musa al-Kazim, the father of al-Rida. And then they start going again to choose the biggest, you know, the eldest one of the children. So they are up and down in how they choose their imams. But what is more serious is their aqidah. That these people, the Shia, which is coming, the descendants of these Shia people, they have invented Aqidah so they can widen the gap between them and Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, so they can never meet with Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, never. One of their aqidah, for example, that they say that their imams, they know more than the prophets and they know more than the angels, and they are in a degree which no prophet and no angel can reach. This is in their books. And I could quote you with the page number, they know that. And it was just narrated in the book of Khomeini, may the curse of Allah be upon him, in his book, Al-Hukum al-Islamiyah. He said that our imams, they are in a situation, they are in a better situation, or in a situation which cannot be reached by any angel or any even Nabi Mursal, a prophet messenger. Then they start cursing the Sahaba and so on and so on. So this is what they have. But each group of these Shia, except the Zaydiyya, and now these Zaydiyya, they don't exist. Even I've checked in Yemen, some of them, they say to me, I am Zaydi, you know, but I curse this and that. I said, if you are Zaydi, you don't curse. You don't even know. So what is famous from them now is the Madhab al-Ithna Ashriya, which is in Iran now. Iran now is doing like the Shia before, tried to control from Morocco all the way. Now you find Shia in Morocco again. You find Shia in Egypt again. You find Shia in Mostar in Bosnia. You find Shia even in Kosovo. When we went to give some help to Kosovo, we find Kosovo Liberation Army, it's got a lot to do with Shia. So they're going everywhere. Lebanon is all Shia now. Shia are going now to Sudan. So they're not sleeping. It's Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah sleeping under the feet of Ibn Baz, who is under the feet of the White House. And this is what the reality, that the Shia are trying to control the whole of the Muslim land. And Muslims are just quarreling with each other. So don't say it's a fitna to talk about Shia, because you're going to be controlled by Shia. And you see, go and look at the Ahlul Sunnah in Iran, how the Shia dealing with them after they have their state. It's dangerous. And one of their aqidah, they said aqidah al-bida', aqidah al-bida', which is aqidah al-bida', that if one of the imams said something is going to happen, if it doesn't happen, that means Allah has changed his mind. No, the imam changed his mind. And one of the aqidah is nikah al-mut'ah, which is nothing but zina. They don't make a limit for any woman to go for mut'ah. And it's no different between a woman went to mut'ah or a man went to mut'ah. A woman could go for a mut'ah and a man can go for a mut'ah. And that starts from the age of 10 for a woman. And she doesn't have to have a wali. And you don't have to ask her if she have another husband or not. You can fancy her, because one, they claim that somebody asked Abu Ja'far al-Sadiq, radiallahu anhu, rahimahullah, they claim in their books that somebody asked Ja'far al-Sadiq, I want to do nikah al-mut'ah with a woman, but I don't know if she's married or not. Then he said, you shouldn't ask for that. You have to trust her in their word. Trust a prostitute that she has a husband or not. This is what they say in their books, it's enough for some of the Shia to pray to drop the punishment from the rest. So if some of the Shia pray, not the whole Shia has to pray. If some of the Shia pay the zakah, not the whole of the Shia have to pay the zakah. If some of the Shia do the Hajj, not the whole of the Shia have to do the zakah. What religion is that? A religion which encourage zina, a religion which curse the disciples of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, a religion which makes people don't pray, don't pay the zakah, don't do Hajj. What is that religion? That's why we cannot really tell that these people are enemies within the Ummah. They are enemies out of the Ummah. But there is some people who just think that Shiism is just supporter of Imam Ali, and they don't know much than that, and they probably have some points of fiqh here and there. We shall not. I have sometimes come people have into the mosque. I just have a couple of weeks ago, a sister, she kept saying, I'm a Shia, I pray, my husband is a Sunni, he doesn't pray, he ran with a girl who is 25 years old. And you find all these kind of things, and you find some people just Shia, and just because they're born in Iran, they don't know anything about anything. Nobody told them anything. You just know all what they have been taught. If you are not supporters of Imam Ali, then you are not Shia, then you are not a Muslim. And the Sunnis are bid'is who have, Allah have cursed them and this and that. You can't call these people obviously a kafir. But what you tell them, you are not a Shia. You cannot tell, many people come, I have a friend, he's a Shia, he doesn't curse the Sahaba, and he doesn't believe the Quran is not complete, and he doesn't curse Sayyidah Aisha, and he doesn't do this and that. I tell him, the right answer for that is you have a friend, he thinks he's a Shia, but he's not a Shia. But don't tell me because of your friend, I'm going to forget what that criminal Shia have done all over the history to the Sahaba and to the change of the religion. In their books, one of the person of Imam al-Jarh wa al-Ta'deel, in their books, what he's saying, he said what was extreme, his name is Maqani in his books. He's a man of Jarh al-Ta'deel. You know Jarh al-Ta'deel, which is the knowledge of ilm al-Rijal, the knowledge of knowing who is trustworthy of people to narrate and who is not trustworthy. In his books, he said, what used to be extreme in the early Shia and not acceptable in the early Shia, it has become now one of the essentials for a person to become a Shia. Do you know what does that mean? It means he says that all Shia now are extreme. All the Shia now are doing things which is the early Shia, the Shia in their early time, they used to call it extreme and not true. But this is how they widen the gap, the descendants of Jews, the hypocrites and the descendants of the fire worshippers. This is how they widen the gap against Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah to make people think it's impossible to unite with the people, with the Sunni people. How many Shia, they really know the story behind the Shia? Everyone, even the Muslims, they think that Al-Husayn was killed by the soldiers of Muawiyah and he was just ambushed and he was killed near... Nobody knows he was killed by his own supporters. Nobody knows what happened to him and his father. Nobody knows it was only purely political matter. Nothing to do with Aqidah. So this is in short, I have many things to say about Shia, but you know, I want to hear from you what is the practical point. I don't want to go into theories. I just give you their history and I did give you some of their Aqidah. And I don't want you to throw or to vomit if I tell you something what they're doing in their fiqh as well and the bad they do. So we looking from the practical point of view how we deal with these people, because they are going like cancer everywhere, even in the peninsula of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Those of you who have gone to Bahrain or have gone to the Emirates and have gone to these countries, they know that they are mainly dominated by Shia, the Gulf, Iraq, some parts of Saudi Arabia, Lebanon, Syria, now going to Sudan, some are in Egypt. Subhanallah. So the matter is very serious and I can see in the future that we will have a long bloody battle with these people, and I could see a lot of the Sunni Muslim blood spilt. And a lot of the Shia blood also spelt in this, and the West is investing very much in that. You see what they've done of one of the Imams of Ahl Sunnah, which is Umar Abdul Rahman, for example, in America, and look what they have done with Khomeini. They even deliver him with their own aeroplane to Iran, because they know these Shia are a self-destructive element in the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the Shia, when they were in control, the one of the branches of the Shia is called Al-Karamita. They have taken the black stone from the Kaaba for 27 years. There was no black stone in the Kaaba. And they have killed the pilgrims there, taking the black stone for 27 years in their own country. So, our fathers, and from Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, they have always stripped them out of power and they've always exposed them. And Imam Malik rahimahullah, he said, "Al-Shia dinuhum al-kadhib." The religion of Shia is just the pure lie. Ajhalun nas, they are the most ignorant people with regard to the fil-ma'qulat. Akdab al-nas fil-manqulat wa ajhalun nas fil-ma'qulat. The most stupid people with regard to the sense of humor and the most lying people with regard to the narrations. So I'll stop at this point, and if you have any questions, inshallah, I will answer it. Any questions? Be all stand now. Start from the right. Yes, well. Yeah.
Where the group came from.
This is what I've said. The place, are you here from the beginning? The incident of Karbala is Karbala is the place where Al-Hussein was going to see his supporters who actually deceived him, and instead of he see his supporters, he found that some of his supporters who called him have joined the army of the city to kill him, and they attacked him and his family, and they have killed him, and he was killed there. This is why it's called Karbala, Karbun wa Bala. Karb means a very severe misfortune. Wabala is a very severe test. So they joined the word Karbun Wabala, and the place is called until now Karbala. So the answer for that they have killed Al-Hussein as they have killed or tried to kill Al-Hassan before. We think they did kill him eventually with the poison. So that is what's happening, that the Shia themselves who have killed Al-Hussein, this is from their own books, from the books of the Mu'arrikhin Al-Mas'udi Wal-Ya'qubi. These people are Shia historians, and they write the history, and these stories is from the history of Al-Ya'qubi and Al-Mas'udi. This is what they've said, that the supporters of Al-Hussein, they invited him, and he was intercepted after they all deceived him. He was supposed to go and see the city ready for him, controlled by his supporters, 18,000 supporters. Instead, he found some of these 18,000 supporters have joined the army of Ibn Ziyad to kill him, and they have killed him. And then the people come and just looking at him being killed and dragged under the radiallahu anhu alayhi salam, dragged under the horse's feet, and they just crying for him, without a single soldier from Sham, from the other side. So this is why it was a karb wa bala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala curse those who killed him, who execute his killing, or even being pleased about it, or kept about it quiet at the time. Which is their Shia. His Shia. These are the people who were very tight with their lives, with their tongues, with their money. They didn't even raise the alarm for him. Waited for him until he come. Dirty people, as they always been. Subhanallah. As they always been. Because they even lie, they even call Imam Ali a coward. He doesn't, he calls his children Abu Bakr wa Umar wa Uthman. After Imam Ali, he has a son Al-Hassan Al-Hussein. And after that, he had Muhammad ibn al-Hanafiyya. After Muhammad ibn al-Hanafiyya, the rumors from Abdullah ibn Sabah start coming, and people start saying, oh, Imam Ali, he doesn't like them. Then he was cursing those who are saying, Imam Ali, he doesn't like Abu Bakr and Umar. So he called his son Abu Bakr, he called his son Umar, he called his son Uthman. He had three sons. He called them Abu Bakr, Umar and Uthman, just to cut the people's tongue. And the Shia, they still have the cheeks to say, if they are followers of Imam Ali, why don't find any name of Abu Bakr and Umar and Uthman in Iran now? Why? If they are followers of Imam Ali, have called his children Abu Bakr, Umar and Uthman. He has one daughter, he called her Umm Kulthum. She was 13 years old. And she married Abu Umar ibn Khattab. Umar ibn Khattab, he asked him to marry. Umar ibn Khattab is older than Imam Ali. And he married his daughter, she was 13 years old. Her name was Umm Kulthum. And he said he's done that tukia because he was a coward. And anybody believe that Imam Ali is a coward? Only Jews say that about Imam Ali. Only Christians say that about Imam Ali. And they have in some of their books, they said Imam Ali, when he was fighting the people of Khaybar, he lost his shield. So he carried the door, which can be carried by 40 people, and he was using the iron door as a shield, and he was fighting. And when he hit one of the fighters of the Jews, he split him into two halves, and his sword went to the seven earth, and Allah ordered Jibreel to stop the sword of Imam Ali, otherwise he will split the whole earth. And Jibreel alayhi salam, he said, I have carried the sword in my wing. And although I have carried the whole village of Qawm Lut in one hair of my wing, I didn't find it as heavy as the sword of Imam Ali. See all these lies? And somebody else come from the Shia, I said, when Abu Bakr Siddiq, he had his bay'ah, then Imam Ali have gathered in a house with some of his supporters, and Abu Bakr and Umar, they heard about him, and then they went for him, and then Imam Ali went with the sword to fight Abu Bakr, Umar ibn Khattab, and then Umar ibn Khattab, he take the sword from him and he push him down. Which story are you going to believe? That his sword is very heavy even for Jibreel alayhi salam, or that Umar ibn Khattab take the sword from him as he's a child playing in the market? Which story are you going to believe? They're both Shia stories. Now,
how many confrontation between Ali and Abu had with
how many fights? Just Sufyan, yeah.
With my poor knowledge, I understood that at a time when it appears that the side of Ali was overcoming his fight, the next day it came with the Quran on their face.
Yeah.
And at that time, Ali asked his people that let me finish this.
Yeah.
And they said that they have brought Quran for the book, and it is incumbent that we should play Quran for our.
Yeah. Order. Yeah.
And at that time, a group from the side of Ali
became Khawarij. Yeah.
And Ali later on had a fight with them.
Yeah, these are the Khawarij.
They were the Khawarij.
Yeah.
And they were all.
They were all. No, these Khawarij are Bid'i people. They are Bid'i people. They've been used by the Shia, but they have gone out of their misbelief, disbelief.
So, Khawarij was yeah. The first people who.
The Khawarij was the first apparent people to go because of their aqidah, because of their belief. But the Shia, they started politically, and when there is no more political rule to play, they turn it Islamically, they turn it Islamically, or turn it believing way, you see, in a believing way. And if you we have made a tape before here also on Luton Center about the Khawarij, and if you see that tape, you will know the whole story about the Khawarij. It's a very critical issue, but Rasulullah said to Imam Ali, two groups will go to the fire because of you. Some they go because of love, and other they will go because of hate. The people who go to the fire because of hate is the Khawarij, the hate of Imam Ali. And the people who go to the fire because of their love to Imam Ali are the Shia, inshallah.
And He was
killed by the wrongdoer groups, which is the group of Muawiyah. We do believe that Imam Ali, he was on the right, and he is the right person to rule Muslims at this time. But that is nothing, this is just political. And this is the opinion of Imam Ali himself. As we said, it was a fitna, and some people have used this fitna. I mean, the Medina was taken over by 10,000 people. And that was the fitna. But we really believe that everybody should actually accept Imam Ali as his Khalifa, and this is something which is, everybody should be pleased and proud that Imam Ali should be his Khalifa at the time. But Imam Ali himself, he did not take it any further than political, and his supporters. Now, yes, brother. No, he was not in the order of the son of Muawiyah, because this is why we believe Ahlus Sunnah Jama'ah, they believe that you cannot go out of the legitimate Khalifa, or a Khalifa has been given bay'ah, or a Khalifa is being taken over by the sword, except he shows his kufr. And Al-Husayn himself, he was asking, take me to Ziyad, because let's not forget that the Ahlul Bayt and the Sahaba who has been with Imam Ali, they had wives from Muawiyah's family, and the Muawiyah's families, they had wives from the Ahlul Bayt from Imam Ali. And you can see hundreds of examples that they don't kill each other kafir, they marry from each other. So this is why Yazid, Al-Husayn radiallahu anhu, he said, if this is a situation, then take me to Yazid. I'll talk to Yazid, because we have blood relations. And this is the way of the Arabs, that they marry from each other. So we don't believe that was in the order of Yazid. And what the Shia say about the lie that his head was taken to Yazid, and then when his head saw Yazid, he said, Allahu Akbar, and all that, all this, you know, It didn't say Allahu Akbar to his killer after he's been beheaded. Would it say to the thing, and all this what he's saying about the rumors that he's been buried in Egypt, that is not right. So I believe it was not in the order of killing Al-Hussein, and may Allah curse those who kill Al-Hussein. Because the Abbasi Khalifa, there was a political fight between the Ahlul Bayt themselves, that the sons of the Al-Abbas and the sons of Ahlul Bayt themselves, the sons of Imam Ali. And the Abbasis, they call the Abbasis because they are the sons of Abbas, Abbas Amr Rasul, the uncle of Rasulullah, and the uncle, their descendants, they took over after the Amawis. The Khilafah Amawiya stayed only for 100 years, but Khilafah Al-Abbasiyya stayed for about 900 years because they had most of the butchers there. So they were cursing them because simply politically they don't want people to be sympathizers to them. They want the Khilafah to stay in the house of Al-Abbas, not in the house of Ali ibn Abi Talib, just purely politically. And this is where people come when they use their personal problem as a religious problem to curse people and call these people kafirs. We still have it onto this now, even among its Islamic groups. You don't like somebody, you curse him, you say he's a khawarij, or you say he's a murji'a, you say it's still happening until now, the human greed. Yeah, brother? Yazid, sorry? With regard to the killing of Al-Hussein, he's got something to do with that. I think he should have done much better than that. If he's fighting the sons of Rasulullah, it is not that easy to accept or to go forward. So from that point of view, yes. But his army was going everywhere defending Islam, and he was also ruling by the Sharia. Although this sin is in his neck, but he still, we do believe he's much cleaner than our leaders now. If you can, but if you cannot, and you're going to cause a lot of agony for the Muslims and the Muslims getting killed, you cannot, Ahl-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah, if you can change the leader, then yes, by all means. And none of Ahl-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah have called Al-Hussein Khawarij because he went out of Yazid. And none of Ahl-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah have called Abdullah ibn Zubayr Khawarij because he went out of Yazid. Yeah? And none of Ahl-Sunnah wal-Jama'ah have called Musa al-Kazim Khawarij because he went out of Harun al-Rashid. Harun al-Rashid, he was fighting fi sabilillah, and his army fighting fi sabilillah. And the very famous say about him, he used to say to the cloud, he said, you go east or west, wherever you're going to drop your water, your goods will come to me.